Glad to be back with you. Being sick is no fun, and I'm thanks. And I'm so grateful that we have wonderful people among us who can step up sometimes at a moment's notice, even though Rick was ready to go from weeks and weeks beforehand. So thank you so much for that. And by the way, I am not Rick, if you haven't noticed. Nor am I Michael, but I am surely glad to be with you. It is an honor to bring the word, and I trust that the Lord would be speaking to us today. By the way, thank you for leading us in worship. Really, really appreciated it. Very much so. So, are you guys ready to dive in? Okay, so there are notes for you in the back. If you're online, welcome. There should be notes somewhere out there in the cyber world. And if you didn't bring your Bible with you, there's Bibles right in front of you, and we're going to be on page 924 as we are jumping back into the Gospel of John. So as Margie mentioned, the focus of this message is on the value and worth of Jesus, which forces us to ask ourselves the question, what does Jesus mean to me? And I want you to think about that and ask God that He would examine us, and so that our hearts hopefully will be overflowing for love for Him. I do indeed pray that God would speak to us today and give us open minds and open hearts to hear what He is saying through our text. As I mentioned, we're picking up the story where we left off last week, as we are going to continue through the chapter break, and I'm doing this on purpose. We're starting with the results of Lazarus and bookending with some further results of what happened with Lazarus. So if you're with us last week, hopefully you'll remember Jesus' powerful claim. He said, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die." Now, he said this statement in the context of a weeping crowd outside of a tomb which held the body of his good friend Lazarus. And Jesus, proving what His words were true, raised Lazarus from the dead. And if you can imagine, this miracle was a powerful and undisputable evidence of the authenticity of Jesus' claims. So this just occurred, and now we're going to pick up our text, John chapter 11, starting with verse 45. "Because of this, therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did believed in him. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. Then the chief priests and the Pharisees called a meeting of the Sanhedrin. 'What are we accomplishing?' they asked. 'Here is this man performing many signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him. And then the Romans will come and take away both our temple and our nation.'" First point, according to your outline, is this: Jesus must be our greatest treasure. Now, many of the Jews who had not previously believed in Jesus, after seeing what Jesus did with raising Lazarus from the grave, they chose to put their faith and trust in him as a Messiah. By the way, the purpose of displays of God's supernatural power is to bring people to put their faith in Christ. And we can say amen to that, right? I'm grateful when God heals people. Does God still heal today? I would say yes and amen. But healing is a means to an end, not an end in itself. It is given to us so that we may trust or believe in or fall greater in love with Jesus. And there's many ways in which the Spirit of God manifests itself or shows itself supernaturally in our time and throughout history. It does so to bring glory to Jesus, to confirm that He indeed is the Christ, the Son of God, and that we can believe in Him and have eternal life or life in His name. And this supernatural demonstration of the power of God caused people to believe. However, not everyone did. Some went quickly down the road about 2 miles from Bethany, where this miracle happened, to Jerusalem to tell what Jesus had done and to tell a story of how people were responding. Now, as we read, the chief priest in Jerusalem and the Pharisees called together the whole ruling council called the Sanhedrin, which is like our Congress. It brought together all of the various leaders at one time to talk about what was going on and to formulate a response. Now, Jesus had been continuing to overcome their resistance to Him. And we have been reading, if you've been reading the Gospel of John, they continue to resist Him. They continue to go after Him. And they had decided previously that they had to do away with Him. And they feared that everyone would believe in Him if they did not do anything immediately. And it's interesting that by their own words, they revealed what they treasured most and what they treasured more than Jesus, namely their religion and their nation. We too today can fall into the same trap. Do you hear me? We have to be careful. If your love for your religion is greater than your love for Jesus, you're a Pharisee and in danger of hell. Right? Hear what I'm saying. If your love for your church and your position in it and love for our church is important, but if your love for your church and your position in it is more than your love of Jesus and your position in Him, you're a Pharisee and in danger of hell. I know these are strong statements, but I'm asking us to think this through. If your allegiance to your country is greater than your allegiance to Christ, you're a Pharisee and in danger of hell. If your passion for your candidate is greater than your passion for the king, I'm sorry, you're a Pharisee and in danger of hell. Jesus must be your greatest treasure over your place in the religious community or your nation. Do you hear me? Unfortunately, in our country, which I'm grateful for, unfortunately and tragically in our country with its political democracy, which I am grateful for, we often shift our priorities from being first committed to Christ to being first committed to our candidate or our nation or our place in our religious tradition. Jesus must be our highest priority. treasure and our highest and first love. Are you hearing me? These individuals, right? These religious leaders were more in love with their temple and its worship and the grandeur of what could have been found there than they were over why it was built, over God, for God, right? Their love for God. They loved their nation and their position in it and its traditions more than they loved God. We have to be careful. Where is your love for Jesus in the priorities of your heart? Jesus's, by the way, promise is greater than any candidate. Jesus's power is greater than any nation. Jesus's position is above all positions. It is greater. Christianity without Christ is hollow. And death without Jesus is final. All the political leaders, all of the religious and military leaders, all of the business leaders will all die, and they're all in desperate need of the King of Kings, who is Jesus Christ. He is greater. His power is greater. His promise is greater. His position is greater than all powers and leaders and all nations. Never surrender what is of greatest importance for that which is less. How important is Jesus to you? Is Jesus your greatest treasure? What would you give up Jesus for? They gave him up, right, for their position, for their tradition, for their nation. By the way, people give up Jesus often, even in our day and age. Well, I'm going to downplay Jesus so I can get greater popularity and more followers on Instagram. Are you hearing me? Well, I think that guy's really cute, and so I don't want him. I don't personally think that, but I'm just telling you. As an example. Or that girl's really cute, right? I'm going to downplay my Christianity so I can get that person. Are you hearing me? Well, I don't want to talk about Christ in my workplace because I might not get promoted. So I'm going to kind of put that on the down low so I can get some more. You guys understand how this works? Of course you're going to say, well, of course I won't give up Christ. And I hope you never do. But I have seen people exchange their allegiance to Jesus for something they wanted more than him. Be it a spouse, be it popularity, be it a position, be it acceptance. We say, well, you know, it was just those Pharisees. I wouldn't be like that. Really? Now, some of you, and most of you, you would never forsake Christ. But we have to be careful because people do it all the time. And we have to remember what he said in Matthew chapter 10. Now, catch this. He says, whoever loves father or mother more than me is not what? Oh, okay. You can read. That's good. Okay. Now, is loving mother and father a bad thing? No. It's a good thing. We're told to honor our mother and father. This is a command from God himself. However, if our love and allegiance to our parents is greater than our love and allegiance to our Lord, you've got some issues. If your mom and dad say, and I've been around families that this is the case, why are you going to church? What are you doing there? When are you going to get rid of this? You know, this, you joined a cult, right? And people say, well, I'd rather be close to my parents than I would to my Savior, and they let Jesus go and hang on to this. That's a problem. Jesus says, if you love your father and mother more than me, you are not worthy of me. And whoever loves son or daughter, right, is that a bad thing to love son or daughter? Absolutely not. We should love our children, but if you put them in the place of the Messiah, you have an issue. You are not worthy of Christ. Whoever does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. If you are trying to find your life and identity outside of Jesus, you will lose your life. If you're not a Christian first, and then a father second, or a wife second, or a child second, or a worker second, or an American citizen second, your priorities are jacked up. What's your first identity? If it's in something other than Christ, you will lose your life. That's what Christ says. But if you lose your life for Jesus, of being in Christ is your primary identity, you will find and have life. Think about this. Jesus is not playing. My hope is that through this series, number one, that your faith would be built up. Second, if you're not a Christian, that you would choose to follow Christ. Primarily, I want you to see Christ for who he is. Often, we have this picture of Jesus as some meek and mild kid sitting on the corner hoping that someone would pick him to join their team, right? Please pick me. Jesus is a great king. Do you understand that? He is sovereign, he is Lord, he is creator. When he speaks, things happen. Power over sin, over death, over all creation is held together. This is Christ, the Lord, who is indeed the Savior of the world, but he is a great king. He deserves our allegiance. He deserves our honor. He deserves our worship. He's worthy to give your life to. His promises are greater. His power is greater. His positions are greater. And these men of the Sanhedrin wanted to exchange God for their position in the temple and their national heritage, right? Now, as they're gathered, let's go back to the text, John 11:49, as they're gathered, then one of them said, named Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year, he spoke up. He said, you guys know nothing at all, right? Do you not realize that it's better for you that one man die for the people than that the whole nation perish? Now, he did not say this on his own, but as high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the Jewish nation, and not only for the nation, but also for the scattered children of God. That's us, thank you. To bring them together, to make them one. So from that day on, they plotted to take his life. Excuse me. The next point, Jesus died in our place. You can personalize it to a greater degree. Jesus died in my place. And made us one. It is indeed better for one man to die than the whole nation to perish. God planned and provided for our salvation by becoming, the Word became flesh, becoming a man. Jesus became sin for us so that we may become the righteousness of God. Do you understand that? No one else is qualified to do this. No one else did this. Jesus is unique above all people. The love of God seen in the sacrifice of Jesus satisfies and shields us from the justice and wrath of God due to us because of our sin. That is the gospel. Right? Where the love of God met the justice of God. Where Christ's perfection was put in our place for our imperfection. And God's love satisfies God's justice on our sin. This is why we must be found in Jesus, because of our belief in Him. And why the better plan was for Him to die on our behalf. And these people who were opposing Christ, the high priest, by the Spirit of God, did not even know what he was saying. Saying, it is better that Jesus died than we all perished. God thought the same. Christ's power, His position, His promises are better, greater, and far superior than any others. In Christ, God provides for our greatest need and gives us a new heart and eternal life in return. And He did that for the Jewish nation and for all of the scattered children of God, which are we. And in Christ, we are one nation, one family, one people, one flock, one faith, one Savior, one Lord. We are all equal in Christ, and we are loved equally in Christ. Please understand this. By the way, we in the West, we in this nation, which is majority lighter skin, more than likely in eternity, those who are of lighter complexion, skin tone, are going to be in the minority in the kingdom of God. Why? It's based on world population and gospel penetration. Right? There's going to be all tribes and there's going to be all nations. That Jesus, by His blood, ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. And we Americans are just one of those tribes. I want you to expand your mind and embrace the world, right? There are billions of people that look nothing like us. That will be in the kingdom. Jesus called the nation of Israel, first died for them indeed, and also the scattered children of God. This is good news for us. This was God's plan for us. Now, this Sanhedrin determined again that they had to do something and do it quickly. And you can see God's sovereignty leading up to the Passover. The rest of John deals with this week or this time. Now, because they chose to do this, let's continue to read in verse 54 of John 11. Therefore, Jesus no longer moved around publicly among the people of Judea. Instead, he withdrew to a region near the wilderness to a village called Ephraim, where he stayed with his disciples. Verse 55, when it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, many people went up from the country to Jerusalem to their ceremonial cleansing before the Passover. They kept looking for Jesus. And as they stood in the temple courts, they asked one another, "So what do you think? Isn't he coming into the festival at all?" But the chief priests and the Pharisees had given orders that if anyone found out where Jesus was, they should report it to them immediately so they may arrest him. These verses, I want to let you know, set up the rest of the book of John. There's high tension, there's anxiety, there's anticipation during the week of Passover. And if you're not familiar with Passover, it is a celebration that we see in the Old Testament where the angel of death passed over the houses of the children of God who had the blood of the Lamb over it. Passover ultimately pointed to Christ, who is the Lamb. By no accident that Jesus was crucified at the Passover. Chapter 12, we're going to continue to read. Okay. Now, verse 1. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Now here a dinner was given in Jesus' honor. Martha served while Lazarus was among those reclining at the table with him. Then Mary took about a pint of pure nard, an expensive perfume. She poured it on Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of this perfume. But one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray him, objected. "Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It's worth a year's wages." He did not say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. As keeper of the money bag, he used to help himself to what had been put into it. "Leave her alone," Jesus replied. "It was intended that she should save this perfume for the day of my burial. You always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me." Next point, pointing to our theme, Jesus must be your primary focus. Greatest treasure? Yes, because of his promise is greater, his position is greater, his power is greater. He died on your behalf and he made us one. Jesus also must be our primary focus. Now, Lazarus and Mary and Martha, this family's primary focus and first priority was to honor Jesus. Is that your family's first priority? It's kind of quiet right now. I have to ask you that. What's your family's number one priority? Education. Is education bad? No. Our family's priority is to get my 5 sons married. Our 2 daughters, in my case. Is that a bad thing? No. Well, our family's priority is to stay together. Is that bad? No. All of those things are bad if their first priority is your family's first priority to honor Jesus. This family was.
It starts with you, parents. Some of you, I know this is absolutely the case, but we have to ask ourselves, where are we at? They valued Jesus more than anything and anyone. In this instance, they threw a special dinner in his honor, and they honored him with a lavish gift of great value. They used this expensive perfume to honor him with a precious sacrifice from their lives for the precious sacrifice of his life. Mary poured this perfume on his feet, where he walked in the dust and the dirt and whatever's on the road, right, of this world. And she used what was most clean and precious to her, right? Her hair, to wipe his feet. The least of Jesus is worthy of the best of us. And everyone in the room was blessed by the fragrance of her worship of Jesus. She was worshiping him. And it changed the whole place. Choose to worship Jesus regardless of your location. School or work or home, it changes things. This was a precious and a powerful moment. And then there was Judas, the betrayer. Even though Judas followed Jesus, he did not do so because he loved Jesus. Which means you can follow Jesus and not love him, which is a major problem. He followed him because he loved what he could profit from following Jesus. Judas saw Jesus as a means to an end. Did you catch this? Judas used Jesus to get what he really wanted. He used Jesus to get money. Mary valued Jesus over all things. Judas valued Jesus to get things. Do you see the difference? Sadly, the spirit of Judas is alive and well today, and those who use Jesus for their own personal profit. Are you hearing me? Just turn on the television to religious broadcasting. Be wary. Some people use Christ to get what they want. They don't value him more than anything else. You seeing the pattern in this passage? Right? Pharisees aren't valuing him. Mary, Martha, Lazarus value him. Judas saw him as a means to an end. So Jesus told Judas to leave her alone because she was doing what was in accordance with the plan and mission of God. He said that there will always be many people who have needs, which is true. But she acknowledged and ministered and honored him first of all, above all others. You must remember that your ministry and relationship to Jesus is more important than
than your ministry for Jesus. Do you hear me? This is especially true, those who are in vocational ministry. It's especially true who those who volunteer at the church, and we're grateful for people who give themselves to do so. But if you are doing things for Jesus, and you're doing it not because you love Jesus, you have a problem. Remember Jesus talking to the church in Ephesus in Revelation chapter 2? Remember this? You can look it up. I'm not making this up. He said, keep doing what you're doing. You're doing all these good things, but I have one thing against you. You have what? Forsaken your first love. My number one ministry first, by the way, is to Jesus. Second to y'all. If you lose connection, we're going to see this in Jesus' teaching in John chapter 15, a vine of the branches. If we lose connection to him, we lose it all, even in the church and even in ministry. And I have seen it. His ministry was first to Jesus. Do not abandon your love of Jesus for your service for Jesus. Service for Jesus, yes. In Jesus, yes, is important, but out of love. Focus on loving him and following him first. And then from that place, turn and be his hands and feet in the world. Last section. Last point. So now John turns to what was happening again in the community. Verse 9 of John 12. Meanwhile, a large crowd of Jews found out that Jesus was there. News had gotten to Jerusalem. They took off to go over to Bethany, and they came there. Now, they came there not only because of him, Jesus, but they also wanted to see Lazarus. They heard about him. They wanted to see for themselves whom Jesus had raised from the dead. So the chief priests made plans to kill Lazarus as well. For an account of him, many of the Jews were going over to Jesus and believing in him. Many points from this, but this is the one I'm putting forward to us. Jesus' work in your life is a powerful witness. Jesus' work in your life. And if you are a follower of Christ, he has done work in you and with you and through you and sometimes in spite of you, right? So isn't this interesting? Not only were the chief priests looking to kill Jesus, but they also planned to kill Lazarus because many people were turning to Jesus because of him. Now, how tragic is this, right? Here's a guy that was dead and now alive, and the keepers of the religious temple not only wanted to kill the Messiah, but wanted to stamp out all remnants and all people who benefited in their relationship to him. This is tragic. It is terrible. It is demonic. This is what they were doing. Now, again, I want us to focus in on that the work of Jesus in your life is a powerful witness to the life of Jesus in the world and can draw others to believe in him. Do not underestimate the power of Jesus in your life to draw others to him. How did you get through that storm? We prayed. The peace of Christ came to me. I put my life on his promises that helped me to endure.
How did you, how do you make it when you are bound to a wheelchair for 30, 40, 50 years? How do you make it? By the grace of God, He has given me joy that surpasses all understanding. I love the faith of some of, well, of those who are here that are older. Val was in the hospital this last week. She's not here today. You guys know Val? Speaks seven languages, by the way. How many of you speak? I barely speak English, right? Barely. You guys know what I'm talking about. Her story is incredible. Oh, she endured persecution from World War II. Her family fled. Being a missionary in Argentina and learning another language and another language and another language and another language. Val was in the hospital this week. She was not bemoaning her condition. She was praising God. Praising Him for His goodness to her. Praising Him. I said, Val, I'm going to pray for this and this. Is there anything I can pray for? Yeah, will you please pray for my daughter? And hey, by the way, can I pray for you as well? Always looking beyond God's power in her life matters. God's power in your life matters. Just tell people. Because your story is part of the greater story of Jesus. Do you understand that? Tell it to honor Christ and draw people to you.